This is a map of the major aquifers across the United States, and you can see that there are a great number of them. They all have these different color schemes, from the Florida Panhandle all the way up to the Pacific Northwest. There are a variety of geologic formations that allow for the collection of water, and we monitor them in different ways because they are being used in a variety of ways. We're going to focus the rest of this presentation on the High Plains or Ogallala Aquifer, which reaches from the southern extent of the Panhandle of Texas all the way north through the Panhandle of Oklahoma and into Kansas, Nebraska, and a little bit of South Dakota, eastern Wyoming, and eastern Colorado, and eastern New Mexico. The High Plains or Ogallala Aquifer is outlined in this figure on the left here. The area is about 174,000 square miles. Each one of these black dots indicates a city that has a population of greater than 20,000 people. So you can see that there is significant desire to use local water resources for these cities across this area. In fact, the Ogallala Aquifer provides about 82% of the water that's used by the 2.3 million people that occupy the lands above the High Plains Aquifer. Well, remember we talked about the source of water to groundwater, to aquifers, being largely precipitation. And this is the typical distribution of precipitation at the surface across the Ogallala Aquifer. And what you'll note here is that the reddish-yellowish colors on the left-hand side, or the western side of this map, show that there is very low precipitation in those areas. And as we move further east into the yellow, green, light blue, and darker blue colors, we get to higher and higher annual precipitation averages. And so the average annual precipitation in eastern Nebraska is close to 33 inches, whereas when we move over to some of the western regions in eastern Wyoming, in those red areas, we only see about 12 inches of precipitation. So there's quite a vast gradient of precipitation that's applied to the surface annually across the Ogallala. The other thing I wanted to note here is that prior to the development of pumping of groundwater from the Ogallala Aquifer, it was estimated to contain enough water to cover the entire continental United States with roughly 20 inches of water. If it were ever to be pumped dry, the expectation is that it would take about 6,000 years to refill. Well, an aquifer is only as good as the geologic makeup, and we see that we have a variety of geologic formations that make up the aquifer, from the tertiary age geology in the north in Nebraska and moving south into the Permian age rocks in Texas. We can also see the contour lines for the altitude of the base of the aquifer in light blue along the map here. And you can see that these elevations range from about 2,000 feet to over 5,000 feet. Because these rocks are fairly old that make up the aquifer, it has been collecting water unimpeded for a long period of time. Well, the other thing that we can look at is the general direction of groundwater flow across the aquifer. The flow velocities are fairly low, 1 foot per day. That's much slower than we see in most of the rivers that move over the aquifer. Generally, we also see that there is a west to east trend or direction of movement of groundwater, as the highest water table elevations are on the western side and the lowest water table elevations tend to be on the eastern side of the aquifer. Well, how far down do we have to go to reach the water surface? In the year 2000, this map was generated with data collected aquifer to try to determine exactly what that distribution looked like. And so what we see are in the very light shades that it tends to be very shallow. So in particular, you can see that from the northeastern corner of Colorado, moving through Nebraska on the southern end, you can see a nice swath of very near surface groundwater. And that's because that's where the South Platte River comes out and joins with the North Platte River and moves across southern Nebraska. If we move further south, you can see through the panhandle of Texas, just south of the panhandle of Oklahoma, the water table tends to be very deep, in excess of 300 feet in some cases. So there's quite a bit of diversity in depth to water across the aquifer. Well, there are a number of large rivers that flow over the aquifer. We talked about the North Platte and the South Platte just a moment ago, moving through Wyoming, Colorado, and Nebraska. We also see the Arkansas River coming out of the headwaters in Colorado and moving to the east through southern Kansas. And then, of course, we also have the Pecos River and the Red River moving through headwaters in New Mexico and Texas, respectively, and heading to the east. So, in general, the northern rivers are draining the Rocky Mountains. Of course, all of these rivers are also can have the opportunity to drain water from local parts of the watershed, more proximal to them as we move downstream. This is a map of water use across the Ogallala Aquifer as determined on a county-by-county basis. Essentially, this range from southern South Dakota down all the way south through Texas indicates that groundwater withdrawals in millions of acre feet go from 0.01, or about 10,000 acre feet in a year, to more than 250,000 acre feet within the 2000 water year. So you can see some hot spots here, particularly in Nebraska along the Platte River after the North and South Platte Rivers have joined together. We also see a hot spot at the headwaters of the Republican River, which starts in eastern Colorado. In Kansas, as the Arkansas River is moving through southern Kansas, we see a few hot spots there as well. And then in the panhandles of Oklahoma and Texas, there are a few hot spots there. There's significantly less groundwater use in southern South Dakota, which is also overlying the aquifer, and in the headwaters of the Platte River in Wyoming. Roughly 27% of the irrigated farmland in the United States depends on the Ogallala Aquifer, so it is an important water resource for agriculture in the United States. And the key agricultural products that that water is used to support include livestock, corn, wheat, and soy crops. If we look at the temporal trend of water use by the different states overlying the Ogallala Aquifer, Colorado, Kansas, Nebraska, Texas, and then New Mexico, Oklahoma, South Dakota, and Wyoming all combined in that blue bar, we can see that from the 1950s to 2000, if we added up these bars in general, there would be a substantial increase. But this increase is not monotonic for any one of these states or one of these regions. And so if we start back in the 1950s, there was sort of the beginning of center pivot irrigation and significant groundwater pumping. We see an increase as we get into the 1970s. And then, particularly in Texas, there's a bit of a drop-off as we move into the 1980s and into 2000. In Colorado, we see very little use in the 1950s, and then an expansion to about a steady rate from, say, 1980 to 2000. Kansas tends to ramp up and peak in about the mid-80s and then drop off. And Nebraska tends to ramp up and peak around 1980, drop off into the 90s, but then surge again into the year 2000. And then the other regions combined, New Mexico, Oklahoma, South Dakota, and Wyoming, start low, much like the other regions, pick up and tend to be fairly steady from 1970 to about 2000. The management of the High Plains, or Ogallala Aquifer, has received the attention of the federal government, and in 1986, Congress passed the Water Resources Development Act, recognizing the economic importance of the High Plains Aquifer to the states, and added Title III to the Water Resources Research Act of 1984. And Title III essentially states that the U.S. Geological Survey, in cooperation with the states of the High Plains region, is authorized and directed to monitor the levels of the Ogallala or High Plains Aquifer and report annually to Congress. In 1995, this was changed to biannually, but the monitoring still has to occur. The objectives of this study include assembling water level measurements from the states that overlie the High Plains Aquifer, that is, Colorado, Kansas, Nebraska, New Mexico, Oklahoma, South Dakota, Texas, and Wyoming, mapping water level changes in the aquifer from pre-development, which is generally accepted to be about 1950 or 1980 when enough data became available to do so more accurately across the aquifer, to the spring of the report year using water levels measured by federal, state, and local agencies. So what that means is that prior to the irrigation season of a particular year, these water levels will be assessed, and the changes from year to year, changes from 1950 or 1980 to current, will be assessed prior to pumping of that current year. To determine the change in water storage in the aquifer using water level data and estimates of specific yield, or rather how much water could be pulled from different parts of the aquifer because it is somewhat heterogeneous in its properties. And then finally, every 2 years to report the water level changes and the changes in water storage to Congress and to the public. Now this data is largely available from the US Geological Survey, and you can find it online for free. Here is the results of this study. If we look at changes from 1980 to 1995, a 15-year period, you can see that the gray, which dominates most of the area of the Ogallala Aquifer, indicates an insignificant change. The blue colors indicate greater and greater increases in water level, and declines are indicated in red. So for the most part, you can see that where there is a change that has occurred, that is, a color besides gray, we see changes of 10 to more than 40 feet drop, water level drop, in many places across the southern part of the Ogallala Aquifer, all the way from central Kansas down to north Texas. The southernmost part of the Ogallala Aquifer in Texas, though, appears to have an increase in water level over that period, about 10 to 20 feet in some cases, maybe a bit more. It's also interesting to note that it is the drier western side of the aquifer, drier meaning drier climate, less average annual precipitation on the western side of the aquifer, that has more substantial water level declines, and that where we tend to see, particularly in Nebraska, the water level increases, those tend to occur where we're on the wetter side of the aquifer, wetter climate, that is to say. And that on the eastern side of the aquifer, where we tend to have higher annual average precipitations, we tend to see more water level increases. Here's an example report from the High Plains Water Level Monitoring Study for 2011, produced by the U.S. Geological Survey, freely downloadable to anyone. And you can see the results on the map in the background here. The explanation on the right indicates that these redder, darker, yellow to orange to red colors indicate a decline in water level, whereas the bluish colors going from sort of a gray through green to light blue and dark blue indicate greater and greater rise of the water level. These changes are noted not just from the previous year, but actually from pre-development times, which is considered to be about 1950 in this case. So in general, if we look across Nebraska, we see that just north of the North Platte River, before the North Platte joins the South Platte, we see a substantial location of decline of water table within one county. And then towards eastern Nebraska, we tend to see more water level rises of about 10 to 25 feet. And you can see that those are somewhat distributed across eastern Nebraska. South of the Platte River, we tend to see more and more declines of water levels. So as we move south through southern Nebraska and northern Kansas, we see a lot of gray and yellow and orange colors indicating water level declines. And as we move through Kansas, we see declines that are more than 150 feet from pre-development times. And the same is true in the panhandle of Texas. We see substantial areas where the water level change has been greater than 150 feet from pre-development. And so we've seen significant changes in the water levels throughout the Ogallala Aquifer. In some places it's beneficial, that is, there's an increase. In some places there appears to be a significant reduction in the amount of water, in the amount of water that is stored. In that case, when we think about the Ogallala Aquifer overall, the challenge to having this as a sustainable water resource for this region will rely on careful management and making difficult decisions sometimes about who can use water and when. The agricultural industry above the Ogallala Aquifer will always be at the mercy of droughts and other climatic forcings that occur. And so the use of groundwater in this area is often required to try to keep that industry going at the surface. How we do that without completely depleting the aquifer or depleting it to an extent that we can no longer use that as a viable resource will ultimately depend on the decisions we make with respect to how we balance withdrawals and recharge. Finally, there are a lot of online resources for looking at real-time groundwater data. So here's one available from the US Geological Survey from the 1st of October 2013, and every one of these symbols indicates a different well. Some of these are only periodically measured, some of them have regular daily measurements made for them. And you can see that the color range below indicates whether the water table or water elevation in the well is low compared to the long-term record, or whether it's on the high end in blue. You can see that there is quite a bit of data in some places, such as North Dakota, Nebraska, Pennsylvania, and then it tends to be sparser in other locations, in particular looking at, say, Oregon, Wyoming, and even Kansas. Let's just take a look at Nebraska versus Kansas for a moment. Nebraska has a lot of dots, very dense data collection being reported to this network, the state, whereas Kansas has a lot of wells also, but for whatever reason does not have them reported in this particular network. So you can zoom in on a place and look at the current conditions, groundwater conditions across. And if you live over an aquifer and know that that's used as a municipal and or local industrial or agricultural resource, I encourage you to take a look at the conditions of your aquifer underneath your feet. The end.